Good afternoon. My name is Vincent O. So let me introduce my profile first. I have the overall 40 years experience about industrial automation and factory automations. So I think last 8 years to involve with the so-called industry 4.0 product and solution. Then at the same time, we also provide a consultant service and also the project management related with the so-called Industry 4.0 and also the digital transformation service. So my experience is more on the hands-on design and also the project management. So I also been the so-called analytical engineer and also the software engineer before. So you actually see my profile. I've been also handled with the analytical, so and also the electronic. So actually my graduate from Taiwan, from Chee University in Taiwan. So I think more than 10 to 12 years actually I was involved more business in South Asia. So I think before COVID-19, I think on 2019, actually I back from Vietnam back to Malaysia. So due to the COVID-19, I know that now everyone need to work from homes. So I think COVID-19 also like everyone to need to adopt on the new norms or follow the SOP and wear the mask when you will go out for the homes. I think this question, I like to ask anyone today that I think on the social media, either social media, Facebook, either Google, when you see these terms, who lead the digital transformation for your company? Answer one is the CEO for the company. Then the B is so-called the CTO, the chief. Chief of technology officers, and C is so called COVID-19.
My answer is C.
Your answer is C, right? Yes, true. The answer actually is true, is C, because now a lot of people is looking for the digital transformation, then move to the new normals from in the South Asia. So why we need to on the COVID-19 during the pandemic COVID-19, you can see that a lot of people is empowered on the more remote cooperation and the productivity. This is why we are using the Zoom platform, MS Team, Google Meet. So this kind of so-called online platform, to let everyone to sit down together, to have the meeting, to have the webinar, to have the online training. So this is why the empower of the more remote cooperation. But one more thing we need to think back, say that when using the more online, more social media, then more internet. So sometimes you also need to worry about the privacy and also the security. This is why the COVID-19 also acceleration on people thinking about the cyber security. So this is why enhancement on the privacy and security or to support the remote work. And then one thing, COVID-19 also led people to thinking about deployment on the intelligent robotic process automations. More people also thinking, I need to using the so-called robotic either automation to reduce the manpower worker on the factory, on the manufacturing. So either detail, so this kind of thinking is starting come out since last 2 years when pandemic COVID-19 start. So another one thing also we're thinking about the AI. So I think last 3 to 4 years we know that when people talking about AI, we feel that the AI is still far away from us. But during the pandemic COVID-19. You can thinking about, we are using the so-called AI driven with the face recognition. Then also we are using the so-called AI to doing some quality check. and also some security check on that. So AI actually is running very, very fast since last 2 years. So this is also the new trend on the when the pandemic of COVID-19 come. So you see that we also thinking about the future product and also the process developments. So people is thinking on the engineer point of view said that we are thinking said that technology is running faster and faster. So I think in the world, every minute, every second, you can thinking that the world maybe in some way of the world got the new technology come out. So I think in South Asia, we now is talking about 4G. So 4G go to 5G. But in China and US, they are now is thinking about a 6G. So it's also the new term come out. So you're thinking technology now is changing very, very fast. So here I'd like to sharing some technology also changes the industry. You see that Square, Airbnb, Uber, either social Grab, so Netflix, Tesla, Next. You see that actually Square is doing the financial service. So Airbnb, either Agoda, either Google.com. So you see that actually you are doing for hotel, then some different kind of service. Uber, Grab actually is doing for transportation. So as we know that Netflix, they are actually doing for the entertainment. So this kind of technology, you see that technology actually is changing the industry. Okay, we also see that technology also changing with the business trend and also the business model. As we know that Uber, either Grab, there is a so-called the world largest taxi company, but they are not have a vehicle. Am I right? They don't own any vehicle in their company. So I think we know that also the world popular media company like the Facebook. I think we don't know what's Facebook. So we are all I think almost our user for Facebook. So we know that Facebook also not have the contents. Then I think during the COVID-19, a lot of people also talking using the so-called platform, retail platform, online purchase to buying something. So you see the Alibaba, they are actually is the world valuable retail company, but they don't have the inventory. They are not have the physical inventory, either physical warehouse to keep the stock on that. They actually share the one platform, let the everyone can share the what kind of item you need to sell on the online. So you see that they actually don't have the inventory. Then another one thing, Airbnb. Airbnb also the largest accommodation providers, but you check back, they actually no own any real estate on their company. So if you're thinking technology also changing with the business. This is another thinking about, the technology also changing the business model already. So what is the next when you is a total the transitional factory, either retail industry, either healthcare. So what is the next? So I think last 2 years, a lot of people is thinking about, how do I transform my company? Either transform my factory. So on here say that this is a so-called digital transformation trend in 2012. So you see that also now we are also thinking about the customer data platform. So we actually will share the customer platform data and share on the Facebook, social media. So I think in our terms, just like I already mentioned, is about thinking about when we using a lot of internet, so connecting each other. So we also thinking about data security. So thinking about cyber security. So another one is so-called the multi-cloud. So multi-cloud is we were also thinking about on the cloud service provider like Microsoft Azure or AWS, Alibaba Cloud, so IBM Mumix. So it is so called multiple cloud. As I mentioned, AI. AI also another is also the new transformation trend in this year. Just now, after we see that, also another one thing is so called a contentless solutions. Contentless solution. So as we know, we also need to follow the so-called COVID-19 pandemic, COVID-19 SOP, or to less or so-called contentless on that. And another one trend we also thinking about the automation. So the automation, we can thinking about how do we using the automation to increase the productivity and also reduce the workers and manpowers. So this is another one trend on that. Then about 5G, as we know that the 5G, the internet speed is faster than 4G. So we also thinking about new future is about 6G. So telco is played a very important role to when you are moving forward in Industry 4.0. So because we need to collect the data, every single data, either on the humans, machine, either from the physical device. So internet speed, we also call the communication technology, also is very played a very, very important role. After we collect the data, we also thinking about data analytics. So how do we filter the data, come out the outcome, let the people know that what is the actual outcome when you collect the data. So big data analytics is let people to know that what is the futures, either what is the next. So data analytics also can using for the predict maintenance. So we can predict what is the next with the machine if the machine got some problem or failures on the motor. Yeah, you say that if we install the certain vibration sensors, so we can so-called monitor on the bearing vibrations. So we can predict how fast this machine this motor will going to break down. This one also is a one trend for big data analytics. Okay, story before transformation. This is I just list down few negative work from the end customers when they are need to moving forward on the digital transformation. So I think a lot of customers say that I already have the ERP, then mostly we need to exchange the data about the system through the Excel. So from the Excel activity to the system. So this next action actually also same with the digital transformation. So when the manual record have the auto record. So this one also the so-called the digital transformation. So digital transformation is just to thinking about how to from the paper record become increase the paperless. Paperless, this one also is one activity on the digital transformation. So we need to thinking about how to transform our current process, how to transform it or enhance it on the current business process, either manufacturing process. This is our angle on the digital transformation. Okay, on here, I also like to highlight. So this is a so-called in the factory, is so-called the manufacturing training map. So here from left until right, you can see that it's a so-called the inbound logistic. When the supplier send some goods, either raw material to your warehouse. So this is so-called the inbound. After you're producing the finished good, then need to send to the the end customers. So this is so-called the outbound, or inbound and outbound. So in and out. So between in and out, we also have the so-called production process. So you need to doing some crushing, mining, either packaging, then send to the warehouse, then send using the courier service, either transportation service provider, send to your goods, finished product, go to the end customers. So this one is so-called outbound. You can see that actually on the whole manufacturing journey, man, actually we built up, actually have the three layer, it's a three area you can thinking about digital transformation. So you see that we also list down in the inbound and outbound. Actually is able to manage your division order. So how many you are using, how many raw materials, then you reship out so-called goods order to the customers. So and also inbound outbound, we also monitor about the optimization transportation on the routing, then also monitor about supply chain performance. Then as we know that inside the factory, we also have the warehousing. Warehouse, we also need to thinking about you need keep how many inventory inside your warehousing. So this is why in the warehousing, actually we are major activity is managing the inventory. You need keep how many stock inside your warehousing. So also we also like to manage capacity and also consumption. Then we always keep the so-called finished good. We also like to monitor the inventory life cycle. We also like to monitor the inventory life cycle. So at least we can monitor about the in and out. First in, first out. So this is the so-called the main objective on the warehousing. So first in, first out. I think third area we talking about the manufacturing execution system. So actually this system actually is like the so-called production supervisor managers, either the factory owner is able to monitor the MRO and WIP. So WIP is a so-called work in progress. So you need to monitor the AB single process. So maybe you can thinking when I run with the, I need to build one handphone by the Samsung. So what kind of process I need to go through? Manufacturing execution system, another one role, another one important function, also it's able to monitor the traceability. They can monitor the traceability function. So they can trace back if the Samsung mobile phone got problem. They can trace back which rod, which process, which raw material, or they control what kind of process. So they are able to trace back when the problem happens. Though another one more thing on the manufacturing equation system, they also can do it for the remote monitor control. So the ISG can using the, they can also using the mobile phone, either template, either web access to monitor the whole production process on that. So this is the three area we're thinking about the digital transformation. So after we see that journey map, so here is so-called the manufacturing transformation topology. So you see that, as we know that in the factory side, we have the four layers. First layers, we are talking about device layer. Device layer is talking about sensor device. Then about control level, is we're talking about the machine controllers. Then another one layer, you're talking about the MES, the machine execution system. Then for the higher layer actually is a so-called ERP, the ERP, the function. So you see that for the every single layer, actually they have the some information you can take from the layers. So you see that the device layer actually they provide what kind of information? Automation control, automation control, safety. Then for the control layer, actually is so-called the HMI, SCADA, alarm event. Then for the MES layer, we are thinking about, they actually is to help us to monitor the product, plan, other factory schedule, product. BOM is so-called the build of the materials. Routing, quality, performance. So what kind of performance? Machine performance, worker performance, KPI. So this kind of thing actually is monitored by MES. So I think ERP actually is a bit similar like the finance accounting system. So ERP actually is monitor the finance, HR, SEM, CRM, CIM, this kind of function. So it's only inside with the ERP. So we are also thinking, how do we enhance after we already link up these four layers? So on the device layer, actually we are able to intelligent the equipment with the reduce of failures and downtime. So here actually we can monitor the downtime through the IoT, either through the machine to machine connection, either we are able to using the MES to link the machine to see the what is the so-called the OEE, so overall equipment efficiency. So this kind of system normally we like to monitor. For the control layer, we also don't know that we are able to doing the production optimize and also the reduce the process cost. So after we collect the data, we see that I can using the this kind of data, at least we can see that what is the downtime per day, per shift, either per hours. So after we are using the so-called analyze the overall data, we can see that using the data to predict some what is the next. So on the MES layer, actually we are let MES control the cost plus performance. They will become the middle bank to help the production manager to actually using the technology to monitor the overall plant either factory or performance. So I already produce what kind of product per hours per day or machine got any downtime got decent or not. So this one actually is MES to handle it. Then for the ERP side, actually we are doing for the enhancement for dynamic cost, industry value. So we are on the ERP side, actually we are already collecting all the certain data, like the worker performance, machine downtime, material usage, warehouse inventory. They are actually ERP is able to calculate if you have the more and more data sent back to the ERP. ERP actually is able to calculate the cost per products. Cost per product in the real times. On the normal practice, now we all waiting the bill or either invoice sent back to the finance department. Finance department may take one or two days either per week to calculate and they feedback the top management how many money are we earn during this order. So I think from the on the top management side, on the factory owner, this one is let them to have the need to take time to make the decision. If you're using the technology to monitor your whole factory, to be honest, you can monitor the factory performance with minute, with either be hours. So I think you are using the technology to monitor, is able to monitor your cost per product, I think with the per days, either per weeks. So I think this one, and let people to know that it's transparent. So let the business owner to make the decision faster. We also worry about, hey, is it my warehousing is overstocked? Or is it my factory, my machine, is this enough to sustain, to support my current order or not? Try to use the technology to doing something. Okay, here on the factory owner side, digital transformation, after we collecting the data, then we are collecting the platform, either we're collecting with the sensor, device, platform, ERP, and yes. So after you collecting, you need see any information on the dashboard. So here we like to using the so-called international standard. It's also the KPI, Key Performance Index. We actually using the KPI ISO 22400. Here you can see that during this ISO, already this down about 34 KPI is related with the factory either manufacturing. So I think number one is we are thinking about the worker efficiency. Then second thing, eradication ratio, throughput rate. I think worker efficiency and throughput rate, I think it's very important with the factory. So we need to see that, is it I using 300 worker? Is it make sure this 300 worker already 100% contract their carbon job scope or not? Also we need to monitor the worker efficiency. Throughput is equal with the output. So output is equal with the money. You produce how fast? So you can after you can produce faster to produce output, you can faster collect back the money. So this one is a so-called one trend. For business owner say that throughput rate is very important for them. So another one thing I like to highlight here is so-called the overall equipment efficiency. This one is also important. So this one also actually lets the people to monitor the, is it the machine already run, stop, either error. So this one also is very important, let people to monitor the overall equipment efficiency. So the so-called the short term is so-called the OEE. Another one is
presentation. Wala eh. Presentation.
Pardon? So another another one is a so-called 24 inventory turns. Inventory turn is like the how many stock inside your warehousing. So is it this inventory continue turn? Go in, go out or not. Go first in or first out. So this one also is also important for the people to know that I really stock how many inventory inside my warehousing. This one also the important KPI. Normally people is monitor on it. Okay, you see that after we collect the data, so you see that event information, time series. After they see the time series, they actually monitor the KPI. So we actually just now mentioned we are using the we currently practice to using the international ISO ISO standard to let the people to know that what is the KPI, what kind of KPI we want to monitor, what kind of KPI we want to monitor. So they say that management and also factory managers. They are able to obtain the information useful to make the objective business decision faster. You see that then they can using the data to make the decision faster. So you also see that on the manufacturing side, they are actually able to obtain information useful for the improve the production side. You can see using the before and after. You can using the before data and see the and also using the big data analytic to actually drill down in detail to find out what is your key problem I think top three, either top five key problem on your current application. Here, on this slide, actually, we already to share with something challenging. We know that we also facing some challenging building your adopting the so-called digital transformation. So here, I think this I need to highlight here is so-called outdated KPI. So this one is very important, let the business owner, either the core team people. From the digital transformation on the manufacturing side, normally first step we would like to the factory owner maybe to form up either set up to one core team. We said we need this core team. You can using the another word say the so-called digital transformation team and innovation team. So this team member actually must come with the different departments. Like the HR department, production department, marketing, sales, either maintenance, or warehousing, they must be involved or must be involved on the core team, so-called innovation team. At least they can share their idea, what is their current pain point, or what is the current they are facing, what kind of problem on the technology side. So is it technology? This technology is able to help them to resolve either solving their current pain point or not. So this is why core team, the innovation team, either core team, must come out the new KPI, for the management address what is the new KPI for the current factory. Or just like I mentioned, for the silo DS. Silo DS. So different department, they got different platform, either software, either Excel sheet form, either job sheet form, either manual record form. This is why we need to integrate together. This is why I mentioned we must form up either come out the so-called the one innovation team, come from the different departments. Then share their current using what kind of form, either recording method. So let the people to digest, either let the consultant to digest. So what kind of technology is suitable for digital transformation. So another one thing I like to highlight here that before to kickstart, after you form the core team, before you kickstart any digital transformation project, at least you need the so-called the practical plan and also come out the digital transformation framework, either plan your current factory. So at least you have your direction and mission and vision, what is the next, what is the plan next for the digital transformation. So after you roll out, either come out the digital roadmap, either framework, you also need the thinking. Is it our current talents, current employee is able to adoption with the digital transformation? So we also to highlight to everyone said that on the technology, either digital transformation, either industry 4.0, talent development is very important. Talent development is very important. The technology can run very, very fast. You can buy the very, very, advanced machine or high technology machine in your factory, but you also need to thinking back that who want to maintain the machine. Or you can buy the KUKA, ABB robot, either Schneider PLC or Wonderway SCADA. You can buy the very advanced technology, but you thinking where the machine, either software platform or problem, who want to maintain, repair, and doing the troubleshooting. Try to thinking. When you need to run faster, you must have the people to support. So just as I mentioned, talent development is very important. It played a very important role on that. The one thing, another one challenge is about innovation. Because as we know that this in the this world is it got a lot of new technology come out. Then in this surrounding area, I think surrounding South Asia, got many technologies already in the this market. So as a owner, either core team. So you must go to either online research, either you can appoint the digital transformation consultant, or either you can appoint a so-called engineer, actually find out what kind of digital tools, either technology tools, or can use it, then to let you guys to move forward faster on the digital transformations. This is few challenge on the new thing you are facing on the digital transformation. So we also know that many companies worry about what is a digital transformation? Is it success or fail? So here we got highlight few problem why the digital transformation for fields. So you see, just as I mentioned, digitizing and already broken the process. So this is why I already mentioned on during the digital transformation, you must set up the core team, either the innovation team, or let the AB department to involve. So then let them to list out the current pain point on their current process. Now try to using the technology to replace the process. So this one is very dangerous. So another one is that it's a so-called chasing the Chinese technology. You can thinking I want to using the IoT to doing some remote monitoring, but is it the machine controller, either machine device is able to connect? This one we also need to think back. And one thing, build up the more platform. No thinking about one platform can support all. This is why, just as I mentioned on the manufacturing technology, you see that we have the four layers. So on the ERP, the ERP got their own function features. On the MES side, as we know that MES side, they are using for the monitor the process or monitor the machine equipment. So try to build up the more than one platform. It's not only one platform can support all function. It's not. This is digital transformation or key point. This is our experience on that. This is our list down on that. So just as I mentioned, digital is a team sport. It's not what people can do all. You see that the digital is the teamwork, team sport, and work together. So you see that on the digital transformation is so-called, we also need the thinking. The business operating models, leadership, system, organization design, workforce, and also the way of working. Try to thinking about what is the new models, and try to using the agile technology to come out, agents to come out. We work together with the different team members. Try to, because you have the different ideas, then during the meeting to doing the arguments. So on the core team, either innovation team, you need to pay the mindset that it's sharing. So sharing and work together, let the digital transformation happen. This is our experience building we actually help the manufacturing either factory owner to kickstart on the digital transformation project on that. So on the digital work, you see that here actually we have to list down some framework. Just as I mentioned, when you kickstart any digital transformation project, you also need to at least you come out the one framework, at least have the guideline, let everyone to know that this is a so-called direction, either business transformation direction on the company. So this here they actually mention business strategy mission. Another one thing is so-called the digital roadmap. Another one is so-called the process roadmap. Another one is so-called the enterprise architectures. So the enterprise architecture, just as I mentioned, is similar with so-called the manufacturing technology. So you see that actually we need to list down. List four big things for that to everyone to kickstart. Hey, what is in the digital transformation? This is like the so-called journey and also the mission of the company. This is why we always tell the customer, you must list down. You can list down and draw out the digital roadmap and plan and framework before you kickstart any single project. If not, you are lost the direction, then you are unable to keep track the so-called digital transformation project. So building up the digital roadmap, here you can see that actually we are already list down. So list down the candidate for digital initiative. So you hear that on the digital roadmap, you must understand. You must understand your current pain point and try to find out what kind of solution, what kind of problem solving tools can help you to solving your digital transformation problem or either roadblock. So try to understanding. So you see that this is so-called the rules and also the way to so-called to build up a digital roadmap and a framework. This is one until one nine. So this is a step on that. How to the so-called the digital transformation consultant, either the innovation team, to draw out the so-called digital transformation framework. So after seeing some theory, let me share you guys with some case study on that. So this one actually is a so-called case study on under the Industry 4.0. You see that for the world largest similar industry. So you see that the Volvo, Zabel, Rolls-Royce. So I like to emphasize the Rolls-Royce. You know that inside one Rolls-Royce engine, actually their total install about 2,655 sensors inside the one engine. They monitor all the performance part inside the engine. They are actually collecting the data, then doing the predictive maintenance, to predict the maintenance and also to monitor the life cycle and also the engine health. So this is a so-called transformation, the big transformation for the Rolls-Royce. So they actually spend about $1 million to install the 2,000 something sensors. Engine to monitor, to monitor the status. Another one is a so-called Zabel. Zabel is a so-called the third largest ODM, OVM electronic factory in Southeast Asia. So you see that they actually spend about $1 billion. They actually spend about $15 million USD to kickstart their digital transformation project, because the ATBD is for whole world. Their whole world got 35 factory in the whole world. So actually their kids start the digital transformation in their US HQ or their main factory in US. So after their kids start the digital transformation project, they actually monitor every single data on the worker efficiency, machine performance. So machine performance actually are also monitor about the uptime, downtime, output, quality data. So this kind of data actually are all stored to one centralized platform to let the CTO and the CEO to know that what is the performance and also the output for the 35 factory in the world. So Zabio is a so-called using the technology on that. Then for the Volvo car actually are using the AR and also the VR to so-called doing the product life cycle simulation and also the installation training. They're actually using the AR, the VR to train their new workers. To train their new worker during their installation on the Volvo car engine. Actually, they are using the so-called technology to on that. This is some case study on the Industry 4.0. So just now we already see that it's a so-called Europe company. So here, I like to highlight here is some Japanese. Then these three companies, Denso, Toyota, General Motors, we know that actually there is an automotive. So you see that Denso, they are actually using the technology IoT. They are using deploy the IoT to monitor the 130 factory inside and outside the Japan. They actually is using the IoT to monitor the factory performance, monitor the factory performance. Then the Toyota, they are also using the technology to monitor the car installation, painting, welding, quality. They are actually using the AI. They are using the AI technology to monitor the quality. So for the General Motor, you know that they are deploy either install about 3,000 to 4,000 robot coming for these 10 years. But last 2 years, kickstart another project is they install the robot gateway, either the PLC to monitor the performance and also the downtime of the robot. You see that they actually is using correct the performance, either downtime on the robot, either the production. Then they are collecting all the data. Then what's the next? Is in order to enable the preventive maintenance. This is another one examples of IoT and also Industry 4.0. In this surrounding world, doing something on that. Yep. So here is a very good result on I building in the Japan become the digital transformation consultant. So this machine is a so-called the BCBA SMD machine. So during I've been the consultant in Japan, so we find out what is the changing time, the touch changing time, and also the downtime on the machine. During the time I find out they are actually using the manual record. They are using the manual record to record down the tooling changing times and also the downtime. So after we are using the so-called IoT, either technology, So correcting the downtime for the machine. So you see that actually we are able to monitor cost to due times, the changing time, the downtime for the machine. So after we are recording the downtime, so we find out, we also doing the improvement on the improvement, the loss or the changeover. So the changeover is related with the planning. So related with the planning schedule, the machine planning schedule. So this is why we see that it's not only the machine down, somehow also caused by the rope repeater not in time sent to the production floor, also caused the machine downtime. It's not 100% come from the machine. So you see that if we are able to use the technology to monitor monitor the overall equipment movements on that. So another one success story is so-called industry safety. So as we know that sometimes we all know the oil and gas company, they are facing the gas leaking. So why is a big issue? So gas leaking in the gas and petroleum company is very big problem. But on the environment side, actually installing the sensors, to monitor the so-called oxygen, either the CO2 data. So when the threshold reach, then you will immediate send to alert to the site control center, and also show the alert on the mobile phones. So this time you also want to try to think a bit. Digital transformation is using the technology, to improve your current process. Then every single project must try to start with small first. After you see the result and outcome, you only to able to scale to other factory, either production. Or no try to thinking digital transformation is big. You see that this small device is just the detection. And you can help protect the worker safety. So here is also the robotic. We are actually using the robotic AGV with the robot management system. To cut off the operating system, then actually we are using the so-called AGV, then work with the 5G network. Actually, we are cut short the warehousing movement, and also we reduce the worker number of worker in the warehouse. So another one thing I'd like to highlight here is we have the one case study in Taiwan. It's using the so-called AR glass, to monitor the production optimization and also the operator condition data. So actually we're also using the glass to guide the engineer how to maintain and replace and install the right components on the machines. So this is here that imagine they are actually using the smart glass, then their view on the then on the engineer can using the smartphone to send back the data to let the so-called senior engineer to double confirm. Is it this component is installed in the right position. So this is so-called AR glass technology. So you see that actually they have the two plan. So actually they are share the main platform on here. So when Tainan factory got any problem, Xinzhu factory is able to support during using the AR class to guide the engineer, either the technician to doing the troubleshooting and either the installation. So you see that, just like I mentioned, in the Tainan plant and also the Taipei plant, there is got any happen, or they are able to using the smart glass to guide the engineer on that. Here is some benefit on that. So here is a one case study in Malaysia. So as you know, guys know that the Malaysia actually is the world largest medical glove producing country. So we are actually doing a lot the IoT process monitoring. So actually we are using the new cost to real time monitoring to monitor the medical glove production process. So here is what kind of data and also device we are collecting. So we are monitoring with a hot water boiler, night control, coolant tank, and compressor, cooling, and also the glove vision cameras. At the same time, we also monitor with the packing system. So this is overall the production line look like. So this is the existing system. So existing system, you know that they are actually connecting using the bobinet, connecting with the so-called Siemens PLC. Then they are actually is using the SCADA to monitor the this field device performance, or that the pH transmission, tank label, alternator running status, and also the chiller running status. Or you see that this is a so-called traditional control method. So actually we are using the new idea and technology. You see that actually we are using install the so-called IoT gateway, as so-called utility gateway, either the PLC gateway. So actually we are replace the traditional SCADA software and use the so-called the IoT method. All the data collecting with the S gateway and through the MQTT sent to the cloud. And using the cloud, users is able using the mobile phone, tablet, either web access to monitor the real-time data through the real-time dashboard. This is so called another new technology on that. Replace using the IoT or either industry IoT to replace the SCADA. So another one, case study actually using the technology to monitor the air compressor performance. So you see that actually we are connecting using the IS45 232 industry communication, or link with the IoT gateway, and through the 4G internet or either Wi-Fi, then send the data with the so-called equipment remote monitoring platform. So using the this platform, end customer is able to using the to monitor the real time monitoring, and also to monitor the performance of the air compressor. You see that actually they send the data. Is able to using the mobile apps, web access, or either the central control to monitor this air compressor performance. But when the this air compressor got some happen either error, this machine gateway is able to send the SMS to alert the maintenance department on the what kind of error is happen on the this air compressor. So you see that it's overall the overall architectures. Here we air compressor, air dryer, air pressure switch. So they are actually air pressure switch is see the air pressure information sent back to gateway. Then gateway will share the data in the data server. This is dashboard example. So the one thing in the market, we now also have the CNC gateway. So as we know that some legacy machine like the passive injection machine, CNC machine, either SMT machine. So actually the machine maker is controlling the so-called interface either protocol. So let people to collect the data on the CNC machine. So in the market, actually we have the ready solution is able connecting with the major plant like the Farnot, Mitsubishi, Siemens, Hetterhans, this kind of CNC controller. So after they collect the data, they store on the database. Then we also can design on the dashboard, let the people, either factory owner, either maintenance teams, to see the result, either the data on the dashboard. Just as I mentioned, also a passive injection machine. Passive injection machine also need to install the IoT gateway to collect the data and store the data. And they also can share the data with the MES and also the remote monitoring platform as a software on that. So in the Malaysia side, actually, well, our project team mostly is emoting with the so-called the cloud machine. So actually, we are using the technology, using the FID tag to monitor this is so-called the grid former. So they are able using the technology to monitor the grid former life cycle. How many times are they tipping and how many times are they using? This one is over using the technology. So I like to summarize here. So on the top impact area for digital transformation. So here I like to highlight is so-called the efficiency. So access utilization. Number three is about the customer experience. Number four is a so-called a new business model. So my last slide, as we know that Industry 4.0 is a new term during 2011. So I think in overall South Asia, Industry 4.0 is still far away from us. So we actually come out a new term is so-called Industry 3.5. So it's a digitalization. So you know that first step is so-called computerization and also machine connection. Number three is also visualize. You see that actually we collect the data to integrate all the platform either machine, visualize it and also analyze it. So this is so-called let people to know that before you jump into Industry 4.0, let's start. At least you have a soft plan on the so-called Industry 3.5. Industry 3.5. Nothing so long, so far on the Industry 4.0. So let's have the some more practical, more easy to reach. Journey. So try the thinking in the Industry 3.5. Thank you. This is my slide.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Vince, for that presentation. We are really into digital transformation because of this pandemic. Okay, so we have here engineer, is engineer here?
Yep.
The next speaker, supposedly.
Yes. I'm here.
Are you there already?
Yes, okay. I'm here.
So before we end, before awarding you your certificate, Mr. Vince, may I have your partner for today's webinar, Sir Tan Chee Fai? Is that correct? Do I have
yes.
I pronounce it properly? Are you also a Malaysian?
Yes, Malaysian. I'm now at Malaysia, at home. Work from home.
Okay, you're working from home. Again, I would like to extend our thanks for having our Olympic gold medalist stay in your country for her training. Yes!
First ever the gold.
First ever gold of the Philippines.
95 years until now.
It's 97. Yes, 97 years. And it's only now that we have our gold. And thank you for accommodating our Olympian. She stayed in your place before leaving for Tokyo.
Yeah, we are proud.
Yes,
okay.
Okay.
And then I work at the Malacca. Because I think I just know that the lady trained at Malacca. Or state.
Okay, Mr. Vince, we will award your certificate later after the talk of Engineer Chee Fai Tan.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay, the floor, I would like to introduce our speaker. See, I already mentioned your name. Okay, he has a degree in Bachelor of Arts University, Pertanian, Malaysia. Okay, you are a mechanical engineer. Okay. He is now connected with RoboLab technology. Is that until this time you're still connected with RoboLab?
Yes.
Okay. He is into digital transformation and industry 4.0 specialization. He has more than 20 years of experience in the advanced engineering industry. He is the professional engineer with practicing certificate, Board of Engineers Malaysia. Oh, you are also ACPE, Asian Chartered Professional Engineer, Registered Foreign Professional Engineer Cambodia, ASEAN Engineer, APEC Engineer, International Professional Engineer. Chee Fai is the Fellow of ASEAN Academy of Engineering and Technology, Honorary Fellow of ASEAN Federation of Engineering Organization, and Fellow of the Institute of Engineers Malaysia. He is now the president of ASEAN Confederation of Small Industry, the past vice president of Institution of Engineers Malaysia. See, he has a lot to his credentials, okay? So, in addition, he's the foreign senior member of Chinese Mechanical Engineering Society, the counterpart of Philippine Society of Mechanical Engineers. He is an alumni of the Technical University, the Netherlands, and Stanford Graduate School of Business. Oh, we are lucky to have you here with us, Engineer Chee Fai Tan.
Thank you.
Yeah, doctor, if I would correct myself, you have a doctorate degree already.
Yeah.
And you are the CTO of RoboLab Technology. By the way, for curiosity, what is IR? In front of your name?
IR just like in Philippines, right? You are ENGR, right? Engineer, right? ENGR.
ENGR for the Filipinos. For Major, you, ear is engineer.
Yeah, engineer. We are also
engineer, Dr. Tan Chee Fai. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
And what is AMN?
AMN is a award. It's a award by the King of Malaysia. I received one award from the King of Malaysia.
Thought it's Association of Mechanical. It's a joke.
The floor
is yours, Engineer Dr. Tan Chee Fai, and we would like to thank you in advance for accommodating our request to be our speaker. As of the moment, we have 140 participants as of this time.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
The floor is yours.
Yeah. Thanks, Madam Moderator, Madam Chee.
Yes, I'm Chee also, but I'm Filipino. See?
Yeah. thanks a lot for your kind introduction. And then, of course, just now in today, right, I just met the engineer Fred. Engineer Fred is a PTC president, right?
Yeah, PTC.
Because we having one discussion about the engineering education for Vietnam.
But you did not come here last 2019. You did not join the group of engineers last 2019. They were here for a visit. I forgot. Yeah.
I've been to Philippines during the curfew at the where's the island? I forget it. Transit in Manila and go fly to somewhere at the Long Island.
The Arctic?
Yeah,
last 2019 we hosted it here in the Philippines, and I was the one in charge of taking care of the engineers and touring them in our windmill.
Last 3 years, I think. Yeah. Okay, thank you. So I just start my presentation. Thanks a lot.
Okay, and, the floor is yours now.
Thank you. I think very grateful and very proud to invited by your group, right? Your association, and then with my partner, Mr. Vincent. He's the one who delivered the first presentation, the sharing. And then he shared about the application, the know-how, the in-depth insight of the digital transformation, and then the application of the various industry 4.0 technology, and then the method, the strategy towards the digital transformation. Okay, now I would like to share something a bit different. Yeah, but of course, my slide will be correlated with the Vincent slide. Okay, so today's topic, I think you know about, topic is unleash the power of digital transformation in manufacturing industry. Okay, my name is G5. I'm from Malaysia. I'm very actively involved in the various NGO. Okay, this one is what I involved. I think the Vincent as well. I involved in many government related agency like the Malaysia Standard, Timor Standard of Malaysia, Malaysia Productivity Corporation, where Vincent and I also one of the expert in this agency. We are the digital transformation expert, and then I also attached with the University Tunku Abdul Rahman. And I'm the past vice president of the Institution of Engineer Malaysia. Currently, I'm also a chairman for ASEAN Engineering Inspector for manufacturing. I'm also involved in various NGO like FIAP. I think the Philippines is very actively involved in the FIAP. And then so I know Engineer Fred, Tan Sisin, and Dr. Forigo, and others, as well as ASEAN Engineer Register, AR, AFIO, and others, right? Okay, so now it's the worst of the time. I think the Vincent already shared, because the pandemic is the worst of time now. So as an engineer, what should we do? So we take it or leave it. I think we need to have a very positive mindset and thinking for us to facing this kind of pandemic crisis. We need to have that kind of mindset. That's why. In here, I show you the Tai Chi, but we're not playing Tai Chi. But this one, I want to show you where there's a crisis, there is an opportunity. Okay, so like what the Winston Churchill said, that never let the good crisis to be waste. We need to take it, think positively, and how to make use of this crisis, and then we try to do something. What should we do? Actually, we embrace the change. We need to change the way we normally used to do it. Okay, during before pandemic, I think we can do a lot of things. Even I can go to Philippines and enjoy my son, food in Philippines. But now because of pandemic, there are a lot of restriction, especially the travel restriction, that make us only able to meet virtually like now. So we need to think about that means that the pandemic is embrace the change. And the world now, there's no returning to the normal after the COVID-19. So now I think most of us, we are going for the vaccination. Hopefully, at the time, then we have many of us have a vaccination, we can travel. Okay, so change is a new normal. New normal. Okay, we need to change to adapt. Adapt on the crisis. We have to go for injection here and there, and then keep ourselves social distancing, and always use a medical related product to protect. Okay, maybe I have a house. Maybe go. Excuse me. Maybe those who are not speaking, please off the mic. Thank you. Okay, for ASEAN, right? I think nowadays, I think people look at the so-called digitalization, like what Vincent say, and automation. Okay, because we try to reduce the contact, okay, and that's the spread of the COVID-19. So we need to we can use a so-called the digital technology, software and hardware, some of the automation technology to replace a certain number of people, to reduce the social contact and to reduce, of course, the spread of the COVID-19, as well as it will embrace what so-called low-touch economy. So even if you and I meet up physically, I don't dare to hug you. You hug me or we shake hands. We try to avoid it. That's why the low-touch economy. What is the low-touch economy? Something like, I think if we have Grab, using whatever we have in our hand. What is that? It's a smartphone. Smartphone, right? We use a smartphone to what? To order the food, to order the grocery product, to order anything, to do anything with the smartphone. So we try to avoid us to go to physical shop. So that's why you can see many of the small and medium enterprises or MSME, they used to have this kind of physical shop. They're having a big crisis now because they're not able to open. If they can open, also they cannot, unable to get the number of the customer able to sustain their businesses, right? And otherwise, a resilient on the supply chain. If because of the lockdown, okay, of some of the country, you can see the world having the big issue in the supply chain. That's why the US, Europe, they relook on the supply chain. They try to readjust their supply chain to reduce the issue on this supply chain. And then I think if you are exporter importer, you are facing the problem. Now I think the container is very hard for you to get the container. Okay, and also the shipment date is not fixed. Very hard to predict the shipment date. And then medical product, of course, is a very hot sales now because of everyone try to avoid to be the victim of this COVID-19. And then the reliance on technology more and more. Okay, so we try to reduce the physical touch and here and there. That's why today we are using this kind of Zoom platform. It's actually the technology, right? So COVID-19 become a catalyst for the ASEAN's Industry 4.0, and no doubt, push a lot. Move very fast forward for the anything related to the technology. Okay, no doubt. We try to avoid not to be physically contact, right? And then, of course, it's the best of the time. Of course, there's a path forward. It means that COVID-19, I think nowadays still very seriously impact a lot of us. I think without the full vaccination among the citizen, I think we have to be careful. Of course, pandemic is not the one that can stop us as a human. We are very strong, right? I think the mentality very strong. No matter what is coming in, we have to fight for it. That's why path forward. So the one of the ways is a so-called digital transformation, right? So in the reality, right, normally the business, the company enterprises, they look, some companies that look very focused on the so-called business transformation. They look into their staff, their system, their strategy, their vision. But it's too much in the transformation, but forget or ignore the digital technologies, there will be something like missed opportunity. Just like I think you have heard a lot of a story and case, right, that's related to Nokia, right, like Kodak, and then the traditional businesses. Why suddenly they've been disrupted by the so-called the new business model? It's because they don't change. They still depend on very traditional way of the business, right? They don't look at the advancement of the technology. Right? That's why they may miss an opportunity, just like a taxi. Taxi normally you just physically, hey, hi taxi, come in. But now, no need. You can have apps in your handphone. Then you can view, book the taxi with your handphone. And then you know the price. You know how the taxi go. Well, who's the driver? It's everything very clear. As compared to last time, maybe they say, you want to go here and there, you need to pay this amount of money. And then no choice. because you're desperate to use their services. That's an impact, right? That's a pain point. So now people changing the mindset because we are too used to the handphone. It's a very, very common now as for handphone. If the company is too focused on the technology but ignore the business transformation, let's say the company too much money spent in the digital technologies, and then too it ignore the business transformation, it causing the something like it may be causing the wasteful investment. Yeah, they don't know, they just know that IoT AI is very good technology. Let's use it. They spend a lot of money. But they forget that this technology may not feasible for them to be used. Not the right timing for them to use that technology yet. That's what will causing the wasteful investment as well. So we have to synchronize our commerce between this business transformation and the digital technology. Why? It's because we want to maximum the technology engagement, the application as well as the business to create the more higher business impact. If we want that, when we invest the technology with the right strategy for business transformation altogether, of course, at the end, I want profit. Most companies, they want to look at the profit, the economic growth of the country, etc. That's why the Germany in 2011, like what Vincent said, they have this kind of policy, Industry 4.0, they launch it, they hoo-ha it. I mean, everyone in the world know that, Germany, now we launched the Industry 4. We want to be the leader in the world, okay, under the manufacturing. It's because they know that they're very hard to compete with the China. China already the world factory. Okay? But the China now, they're moving very fast. They don't want to just become the world factory. You set everything there, then they make everything, and then come up with a lower value of product. Now China going for higher value of the supply chain. They go for high value product. Okay? So this one, I'd like to introduce you about what's the meaning of the digitization and digital transformation. First of all, is a digitization. Just like you wear the mechanical watch. Okay, so now you have something, you buy the digital watch like Casio. From here, you need to always turn the watch right to make it run. You just put inside the battery then, and then from this watch you can know about your time, the alarm, can become your sport watch, etc. Right? This is called digitization, transform from mechanical to the digital. Okay, how about digitalization? For the digital watch, right? Then you buy the another one, upgrade, you buy the so called the smart watch. Okay, for this smart watch, I think if you're non-GSM one, I think you just you can monitor your heartbeat, your exercise pattern, your sleeping pattern, and then some you can pair with your earphone, right, with the Bluetooth, and you can listen music and do other scheduling as well. Because this smartphone can pair with smartwatch can pair with your smartphone, right? But of course, some smartwatch, right, you can put a SIM card there and become a handphone by itself. So you can know, I using this watch, I know more than that as compared to the digital watch. I have more application that can use because this one can pair. This is called digitization, right? It's the use of the digital technologies to change your business model and provide new revenue and value producing opportunity, right? How about the digital transformation? Now, if you're the producer to produce this smartwatch, but your smartwatch already very hot sales. Many people use your smartwatch. Okay? And you're the one who create this, who design and develop this smartwatch, the apps itself. And then from there, you capture so many data. You capture the location of the user. Okay? You capture the health. The health status of the user, the behavior of the user, etc. There's so many information, the data. Okay? Okay, so many data. So from here, then you can think about, hey, I have got data. Maybe I can analyze the data. Okay, to what? For what? To understand the consumer, the behavior. Like today, you know I'm talking. You don't know actually who am I, even though there are some introduction with the by the moderator. How you know my behavior? Actual one. Of course, every one of us always have the handphone in our hand. From here, actually, to capture the behavior is very easy. Yeah, especially when we always like to download and install the free apps. Actually, free apps actually be, but for the back end, they capture a lot of information. Okay, like the behavior where we are, because we also switch on the GPS. They will locate us. They know which location in the Philippines is the most people will concentrate. Then we know, that place maybe something, a business opportunity for me. Okay, so in this digital transformation, it's a rethinking of how an organization uses technology, people, processes in pursuit of new business model and new revenue stream, driven by changes in customer expectation around product and services. It means that I know better about your need. I create something that you sure buy it. I don't like because you not suit me. But if I cater for your need, let's say you're the age group, within this age group, I know what's your preference. As well as I know this is a group of engineer. I know their behavior, their mindset. Then I cater for their need, right? Of course, at the end, right, the digitization is actually to enable the company to have a more business insight. Okay, it means the organization is more efficient and effective because you know what happened actually in your operation, in your shortfall, in your process. You know, okay, just like I think Vincent has shown you a very good example of the application of the technology to improve process. Another level, so-called digitalization. So from this, the data able to optimize the business. Yeah, because you capture a lot of information. From that, you know, this is the trend now here and there. Then you know what should you do, to avoid or to focus on the market. This one become a data driven organization. The next one is a business transformation. Or business transformation is the company become a data company. So it's based on the data, the data from the from in-house, from internal, from external, then you can align. Okay, you can do the better planning. You know what to do. That's just like today. I know most of you are the electrical engineer. So I need to cater your need. I need to explain and share with you something that you want to listen, let's say. And then of course, for the manufacturing, of course, there are many methods that have been used by the industry. By the CNC, SPC, so-called statistical process control, and some of the tools like predictive analysis, etc. Actually, at the end, is for the company to look for the higher value outcome. Okay, why I need to want to know a lot of data? Okay, why I need to have a very good method model. To really analyze the data, to capture the data that I want, to understand the data and to understand the market, the world market as well, because I want to know exactly what the industry want, what the market trend like for the higher value. Okay, this is one higher value. It can be horizontally interconnected. So I can know about my vendor, my supplier performance, and the effectiveness. And also I can know about my client. I know my client need, what's their actual need, what they want. As well, I from the vertically, from the different hierarchy, I think the just now Vincent show that the hierarchy, the different hierarchy of the company, the system level, and then from there all integrated all together to kill off all the silo. To kill all the island, to link the bridge between the island itself. Of course, we also look at different angle as well. Next one, I want to show you what happened in ASEAN. Okay, what happened in ASEAN? That related to the ASEAN country policy that related to fourth industrial revolution. So far, there are five countries. That's the latest one. Five countries have the policy that related to fourth IR. Okay, by the first one on the top, Singapore. Singapore have a smart nation agenda and digital economy framework for action. Okay, it started around 2014. It's quite early. The earliest among the ASEAN countries they have this kind of policy. Okay, and then they have another one, digital economy framework for action in 2018. Next one is Thailand. Thailand have the so-called Thailand 4.0 strategy. And another one is a digital economy and society development plan. So both of them, both of these policies started in 2016. Indonesia, they have a so-called Making Indonesia 4.0. Okay, it started around year 2018, similar to the Malaysia. Malaysia, we have a so-called national policy on Industry 4.0 or Industry Forward, as short. And then Vietnam. They have the so-called national strategy on Industry 4.0 and future digital economy towards 2030 and 2045. These two policies launched around 2019. You can see these five countries among the countries that have this kind of 4IR. But for others, I think for Philippines, I think you have a digital policy, right, if I'm not mistaken. Okay. Next one, just show you what's briefly for each country in ASEAN, what they have. Malaysia, we have this kind of so-called national policy on Industry 4.0. Okay, it launched in the 2018 October, okay, before a pandemic. So these policies are focused on three objectives, ACT. First of all, is to attract the stakeholder, especially the small and medium enterprises, to be in the policy, to grow them, to adopt the Industry 4.0 technology, and make Malaysia as a preferred location to promote the foreign direct investment, of course. And secondly, C is to create. Is to create the right ecosystem in the Malaysia. Okay, let's say I think just now Vincent also sharing about the talent. Okay, you have technology, you need to have talent to support the entire ecosystem as well. Also the Malaysia also create the so-called collaborative platform. Okay, no more alone. In this industry 4.0 era, you are not alone. We need to work together for something. Yeah, that's why we have the collaborative platform, and of course, to need to build the right digital infrastructure. The so far Malaysia with 4G going to 5G, and then with funding support from government to encourage the industry to go for this kind of industry 4.0 adoption, as well as the data availability and sharing and innovation. That's why it means also sharing innovation capacity must be there. Because the technology, just technology. Okay, you need people like us, we as an engineer, technologists or technician, to innovate the application of the technology, right? You know IoT, but IoT is just IoT, right? But how you apply this IoT in your operation, in your country, then you need to have an innovative idea. Okay. Next one is a transform Malaysia. Okay. Actually transform is correct. To transform Malaysia going for the high value, high income, increase the productivity and share the possibility and cost efficiency, etc. So in Malaysia, we have about 11 technology enabled. If you know about the World Economic Forum, only have 9, right? But Malaysia, we have 11. What's the two extra two? Later, I'll show you now. Okay, first of all, of course, big data analytics, BDA. AI, I think very common. Artificial intelligence, AR, augmented reality, just now Vincent also sharing about this application, and cybersecurity, it's not the antivirus, it's a different level, and then additive manufacturing or 3D printing, and IoT, simulation, and application of software, CAE software, or process simulation software, etc. Okay, and then this is the extra one. System integration. In Malaysia, we also very focused on the system integration because we have so many technology. We need to have a system integration people inside the ecosystem, and then we have cloud computing. This one also extra advanced material. They focus pretty much on the sensor. and then we have the autonomous robot. Okay. Besides this policy, Malaysia also just launched the so-called National Fourth Industrial Revolution 4IR policy just recently, 2 weeks ago. Okay. The intention is to equip the people of Malaysia with the 4IR related knowledge and skill set. Secondly, to form a nation with connectivity through the development of digital infrastructure. That's why infrastructure play a very important role, not only for urban, also for the outskirts, to have to enjoy this kind of connectivity as well. Thirdly, to provide appropriate rules for future needs so that they are flexible according to technological changes. And fourth, to accelerate innovation again, and adoption of 4IR technology. So this is how it looks. The four policy trusts. First one is to equip the people with the knowledge, training, upskilling, reskilling, right? And then forge a connected nation with the digital infrastructure. That's why Malaysia, we are very mature, we have quite mature.